If you look at the beauty of this humanity, you will be surprised, you will be happy to be born as a human being. We don't possess the sharpness of the eye of an eagle. We don't possess the teeth of a tiger. And we can't fly like a bird. We cannot jump like a monkey. So as far as the physical capacity of human being is concerned, we are very ill equipped, we are under equipped to lead a life. We are very, very under equipped to lead a life given the physical abilities which we have. But one thing which is making us the most powerful living creature on this earth is not just our physical capacity, but our mental ability. We have the power of thinking. We know how to tap the power of our mind. And that is why we are controlling the world today. So you don't have the power of a lion, you don't have the power of a tiger, you don't have the power of an elephant. You are nothing in front of the wildlife or wild animals. But just because you have the capacity to think, that you are controlling the entire universe. So the story is this, that you have been endowed with the finest capacity called your thinking capacity. Use this thinking capacity constructively. Don't fill this mind with negative thoughts, because always negative thoughts will be creating a negative vicious cycle, and we will be trapped into that negative or vicious cycle. So you have to have a positive thinking so that you will be very much happy in a virtuous cycle rather than getting trapped by the vicious cycle of negative thinking. Get trapped by the virtuous cycle of positive thinking. Be positive. That winners will see only the gain in the pain, losers will see only the pain in the gain. That is what is the main difference between the winner and the loser, no? The winner sees the gain in the pain. He is ready to get the pain because there is a gain. But the loser will see the pain in the gain. He is very much bothered about pain, not the gain. And that is what is the attitude which I wanted all of you to have, with which only we can do wonders in this UPSC examination. Basic steps which you have to follow when you write your main answers. The first important step is, your writing should be very simple. Simple does not mean that you should not use jargon. You should use jargon, but it should be very simple. Meaning that one or two words in a statement can be jargon terms. And simple means that I will write a statement not more than two lines. I will not write a single statement in 10 lines. In the 8th line, you will be completely out of the track or from the first line. And you will start with something, you will be in between something, and you will end up something. You will be disconnected with your statements. So try to make two lines in a statement. And suppose if you have a statement which is a very, very attractive statement, like a punch dialogue, use the punch dialogue frequently, and try to be very, very conscious about the page limit, not the word limit. Two pages, see how many pages they have given, because they are changing it. Sometimes for the 20 marker question they are giving 4 pages, sometimes for the 20 marker question they are giving only 2 pages, 3 pages. So don't have a preconception about how many pages the question you have to write answer for. See physically how many pages they have given for short notes, how many pages they have given for long answer. Because in the test question, I am giving a practice of making you write 4 pages for a 20 marker and 2 pages for a short notes. Sometimes what happens, for a 10 marker they may give 3 pages and for a 20 marker they may give 5 pages, who knows? So you will think that I have to write only 2 pages, you will write 2 pages, another 3rd page is left free. So page limit is the limit, not the word limit. Next important point is paper completion. Paper completion is very, very necessary. Those who have completed the paper in 2017 examination, they have got 286, 293. And those who have not completed the paper got stuck up with 260, 250. Paper completion is the key. And time limit. Time limit is very, very crucial. So follow these guidelines from the first test onwards. The test which you have written an answer. Now I will give you a model answer. You will come to know what are the things which you missed in your answer by keeping the model answer as the yardstick. Thereby you are correcting yourself, meaning you are rewriting the discussed answer once again. Don't be too slow in writing, be fast. Little bit you have to be fast from the first. So instead of spending 20 minutes for a long answer, 15 minutes for a long answer, you can spend 20 minutes for the first question. But in the second question, instead of writing for 15 minutes, you have to write within 12 minutes. Second question itself, you compensate the loss of time, otherwise you cannot finish the paper. Don't just drop the name of the thinkers mechanically. Don't run after the thinker's name. Every line will be thinker name. Emil Durkheim, one line. Next line, Max Weber. Next line, Karl Marx. Next line, Robert Bierstadt. Next line, Karl Popper. Next line, Thomas Kuhn. Next line, G.H. Mead. Every single line, you don't write the name of the thinker. Use the thinker in appropriate places. Don't use it too frequently, because there will be a little bit. Overfeeding is also bad. Don't overfeed the answer with a thinker's name. It will be like you don't have anything on your own. You don't have a creative thinking, so you always borrow the ideas from others. So you are not a self-made person, you are a dependent person. You are not an independent thinker. Without thinker name, this also is a disaster. Too much of thinker name, excess and vice, both are disease. According to Aristotle, excess and deficiency, both are vices, both are disease. Too much nothing, don't go to the extremes, try to stand in between. Optimal use of the thinker's name. And don't mechanically drop in. Mechanically dropping means develop an argument, then write the thinker's name. In one paragraph, start with the name of the thinker. In the another paragraph, end with the name of the thinker. If you start always with the name of the thinker, then it becomes very boring to correct your paper. So these are some of the steps which you have to follow when you start writing the sociology answers. The most important. Read the question, underline the keyword present with the question, repeat the keyword in the first paragraph itself. It will be ideal to write in the first line, the keyword present in the question. This will connect your answer with the question. Use keywords in the question repeatedly, frequently, directly and indirectly, frequently use the keyword present in the question. As for the source of the sociology is concerned, I have told you, other students who have not taken the regular class here, I am telling to you that there are three volumes which I have given. Two volumes I have given already. One volume is currently ready. In a week time you will get it. So paper 2 yet to be given to you. In a week I will give to you three volumes of sociology. Use it as a reference material. Apart from that, whatever you are reading in the Hindu paper which is related to sociology syllabus can be added as a value addition. Understood? Any doubt? Right? So we'll start with the first question. I've told you discussion is one by one, but the answer writing should be long answer should be first. 1A, common sense is neither common nor sensical. Critically discuss. I am reading the question, common sense of the question asked. I have in the syllabus the word called common sense in sociology, common sense in sociology in the first unit. From that syllabus word topic I am going to the class lecture and the textbooks, and I am pulling points from there. This is the process which every one of you will have to follow. So what is the answer which you can give to this question? How you will start the answer? Starting should be impressive. Ending should be very impressive. Because in the conclusion only they are going to give you the score. What should be the introduction? Common sense is not common, neither common nor sensical. Common sense was regarded as a fallacy fostered by culture according to positivism. August Comte argued that divorcing common sense from sociological theories will make sociology as an independent discipline with a scientific status. Critics to common sense argue that common sense is not shared commonly by all people in the society because of individual discrepancies, individual idiosyncrasies. If common sense is commonly shared by all, then every actor present will be a robot programmed by the society. People will not engage in an activity which is not good for them. People won't gamble. So common sense on one hand is not shared by all because of individual differences. At the same time, common sense is not sensical for the simple reason it is not rational. Common sense refers to a sound judgment based on individual experience decided by the culture. The society tells you that birds of same feather flock together, but science tells you that opposite poles attract each other. Both are diametrically opposite conclusions. So the status of common sense in the sociological imagination was central to the debate since the emergence of sociology as a scientific study of society. Now next paragraph you write, how positivism criticized common sense. Renaissance scholars sowed the seeds of rationality and scientific temper, wanted to use reason and logic to reconstruct the society based on invariant laws of natural science. August Comte positioned sociology as a scientific study of society. He wanted sociology as the mother of all social sciences. He even was given the term social physics for sociology before. Like physics can predict reality objectively based on empirical knowledge, sociology should build its sociological theories derived from theories using the logic of science. So he wanted common sense to be rejected for making sociology as a positive science. Following the footsteps of Auguste Comte, Émile Durkheim also wanted sociology to become a scientific study of society. He went to the extent of even deriving a law of suicide on the lines of law of natural science. For positivists, sociological conclusions, if derived from commonsensical knowledge, will drive the society towards backwardness and irrationality, will result in social continuity rather than social dynamics. However, non-positivism rejected the scientific status of sociology. It wanted sociology to be based on individual experience, which is decided by the culture, which varies across time and space. They, especially phenomenologists, were looking at how common sense presents the raw material for the construction of hypotheses. Hypothesis is the starting point of your theory, but sourcing its inputs from sensory knowledge, which is personal in nature. Robert Madge says, people derive truth not only from the culture of the society, but also from the individual experience which they are exposed to. So truth is not just a product of science. Theories are not basically the outcomes of science. Theories can draw its raw material from common sense, is what is the idea postulated by non-positivists. Sociologists in the contemporary social world conclude offering common sense an important position in the construction of sociological theories. They don't discard common sense. They argue that man is a product of law as well as customs. Human action is decided by both rationality and emotional. So man is not only looking at the world through his scientific rationality, but also he is using his personal experiences of the past. He is having a conception about future. He is involving in what C.W. Mills calls sociological imagination. So today, sociologists are more interested to study how much is proportion of common sense and how much proportion of science is used by sociologists in the construction of social realities and sociological theories. Right? So this may be your answer. Right? So you are using the keyword, you are bringing two main theoretical points, one is positivism and non-positivism, and you are giving a balance by telling that it is a not exclusive. Common sense and science are not exclusives of each other, rather they are inclusive of each other. You cannot draw sociological inference divorcing one from the other. So 1b is studying unobservable meanings and motives compatible to scientific theories or scientific subject. Do you think that you can easily study unobservable reality to develop scientific theory or to develop a theory of society? Unobservable facts or unobservable phenomena can be studied objectively or not? This is nothing but a topic related to, is sociology a science? Studying unobservable reality or unobservable phenomena, is it compatible with in a social science, or it is it compatible with a scientific subject? Nothing but a debate on the scientific status of sociology. So you can start with the emergence of sociology as a positive study, as a positive science of society. Emergence of sociology as a positive science of society in 19th century, the seeds of which was sown by positivists, especially Comte and Durkheim. Positivism, Comtean positivism, rejected the role of unobservable reality in the study of social reality. For Auguste Comte, study of society should focus on deciphering, understanding the underlying social structures which are subjected to continuity, which are routine, which has normative components, but which guides the social action. Comte looks at study of human society from the prism of social statics more than social dynamics. Auguste Comte wanted sociology to develop scientific theories, or sociology should have to follow the principles and the methods of natural science in the construction of sociological theories. He rejected the role of individual mind for the simple reason that you cannot arrive at a pattern if you study the individual idiosyncrasies or the individual desires. Studying individual mind may depart sociology from its goal to develop theories. It will end up as psychology, not sociology. According to Auguste Comte, people may marry for multiple reasons. The individual reasons should not be the primary focus of the sociologists. They have to study institutions rather than individuals. They have to confine their observation to the structure and not to the actor. He even went for law of three stages, giving a sociological conclusion about social change. However, criticism against positivism came especially in German sociology. It was idealists like Hegel, Immanuel Kant, who looked at the importance of social science from the prism of study of values. They are of the view that study of natural world is strikingly different from study of social world. The natural world is composed of facts. The social world is composed of values. Facts are observable entities, whereas values are not subjected to empirical research. So positivism gives priority to empiricism, whereas non-positivism gives importance to the role of ideas, the importance of values which guide human action. Karl Popper says that it is desirable to have sociology as a science. But however, sociology is having a sociologists have to encounter a problem when they study values. They are studying hypotheses, constructing hypotheses, but this hypothesis may not be sourced from theories. Hypotheses can come from nowhere. All swans are white is a hypothesis which can be potentially falsified. So sociological theories using scientific logic should not follow exactly the footsteps of natural science. They have to look at the possibility of falsifiability, which would make hypotheses reliable. So he says sociology is maturing and it is marching in the direction of science, but it has not become a science. Even Thomas Kuhn accepts this. He says sociology is pre-scientific, it is pre-paradigmatic. Sociology is pre-paradigmatic, hence sociology is pre-scientific. Sociology will have to travel miles to become a science. But the realist view of science, look at how natural science and social science do not have a goal which is compatible to each other. The goal of natural science is to study a closed system. The goal of social science is to study an open system. So laboratory experiment can be used in a closed system. Comparative method only can be used in the social science. They are also looking at how science may not be able to predict precisely all types of reality. No seismologist can predict when earthquake will occur. No doctor can predict when a disease will hit a human being. But however, they are not automatically rejecting interpretation they are accepting interpretation in the development of sociological theory, but at the same time they are looking at the possibility of sociology to become a science. So it may be compatible for sociology to study the non-observable facts to become a science, even though sociology is not a natural science. So the sociological, or so the scientific status of sociology today is getting a conclusion that neither it can be called as no science nor as a natural science. Sociology desires to study society objectively as much as possible, for the reason that sociology is not a natural science, but it is a social science. What is the question? Sacred and profane. What should be your answer? For Immanuel Durkheim, social experience influences the thought process of every human being in a society. Since the social experience is dualistic, thought categories are also dualistic, subjected to the principles of binary opposition. Religion is the most powerful force in the society, with the help of which the social world is categorized into binary genera, the world belonging to sacred and another world belonging to profane. For Durkheim, religion is nothing but a unified system of beliefs and practices related to sacred things, that is, things that are set apart and forbidden from the profane. So sacred is what is decided or constructed by society. According to Immanuel Durkheim, sacred has the following characteristic features. Number one, nothing is sacred or profane in itself. Sacred is nothing but superimposition of the society. Number two, sacred is non-utilitarian, unlike magic, which is utilitarian. Number three, sacred is ambiguous. It is benevolent at times and malevolent at times. Number four, sacred expects people to show reverence, for which it is expected to reciprocate. So sacred gives you a world characterized by an identity, solidarity, and social control. Centering around the sacred, an identity is constructed. For Durkheim, the totem name becomes the name of the group. So it designates the members of the society into a group. Sacred designates the members of the society into a group. By making people as a group, it gives you social cohesion. unity. It gives you a social bonding. And it gives you obligations by being a member of the totem, which is sacred. It gives obligation to the level of kinship obligations. And the sacred gives you social control. It gives you a system of interdiction, that is do's and don'ts, which controls the human behavior. Durkheim, in a study of elementary forms of religion, looks at how sacred is nothing but the projection of the society. Sacred is only the symbol of the society. And sacred is ultimately society divinized. However, this categorization of world into binary opposites was rejected by Edmund Leach, who says much of the social life is in between these two extremes of sacred and profane. It is mundane. Critics also point out how religion is utilitarian, sacred is utilitarian. The presence of politics using religious ideology, on one hand, speaks about how Durkheim correctly pointed out that it is unifying people into one single moral community called the church. At the same time, R.K. Mutton says the use of religion can be to divide the people and cause communalism and religious fundamentalism, for which society is, for which sacred is society divinized, is unacceptable for the critics of functionalism. Study of reality sui generis is sociology. What is the topic? Study of reality sui generis is sociology. What is the topic? Social realism. Good. Social realism. So you should start writing about the perspective of Emil Durkheim, that is social realism. Even if you write collective conscience, you are right, because collective conscience is also social realism. Even if you write social fact, you are right, because social fact is also social realism. Emil Durkheim wanted to give sociology a perspective distinct from the other branches of social science and natural science. When reality is the study of science, social reality should be the perspective of social science, especially sociology. Reality, according to Emil Durkheim, has multifaceted dimensions. There is a physical dimension of reality, biological dimension of reality, chemical dimension of reality, psychological dimension of reality, economic aspects of reality. And being a sociologist, one should look at only the social dimensions of reality, that is social reality. He is looking at the emergence of society out of the collectivity of the individual members. From out of individuals emerges a collective tendency. According to Emil Durkheim, parts combine to form a whole, but the whole is more than the sum of the parts. It is akin to a concept called synergy given by Lester Ward. The whole cannot be reduced to the summation of the parts. Brain is composed of many cells, but cells summation would not per se result in the brain. The study of brain cannot be reduced to the sum of the cells of the brain. He is coming closer to organismic analogy of Spencer. That society is like an organism. Parts of the organism combine to form an organism, which is a new level reality. So individual members develop a definite patterns of relationship. Consequently results a new level of reality, a reality which is a higher order reality, and this reality is sui generis reality, and this sui generis reality is nothing but your society. So study of social consciousness cannot be reduced to the sum of the individual psyche. Collective conscience cannot be reduced to the sum of the individual conscience. Collective consciousness is a new type of reality. This new type of reality controls the constituents of reality. The new type of reality is external to the individual members of the society. It is independent of the individual members of the society. It is generally diffused throughout the society, and it controls the individuals through norms, customs, and habits. Sociology should therefore focus more about social realism and social determinism. However, critics point out that, especially non-positivists argue that, Emile Durkheim in his ambition to construct a, chart out a separate path for sociology has only ended up committing excesses in the form of extreme social realism. He has committed excesses in the form of extreme social realism. And this extreme social realism should be replaced by interactionism, phenomenology, ethnomethodology, and social action perspective. So in 19th century, there was more and more tendency towards social determinism, and from 20th century, there was a drift in the sociological school of thoughts towards non-positivism, which is a challenge to extreme social realism, trying to give a synthesis of individualism and collectivism. Emile Durkheim, in the social division of labor, looks at how division of labor is not an economic fact, it is only a social fact. The biggest consequence of division of labor is social solidarity to the society, not just material advancement. But however, he is looking at the nature of the social crisis present in 19th century France, which was supposedly to be based on organic solidarity. which has an inbuilt solidarity which is more solidary than mechanical solidarity. If organic solidarity gives more solidarity than mechanical solidarity, if organic solidarity is present in French society of 19th century, then why there is a confusion in France? Indirectly he speaks about what division of labor is supposed to function. It is not doing that. Implicitly he speaks about the concept of latent function which became an input for R.K. Martin to develop the concept of latent function as against a manifest function. He explores the reason for the abnormality present in division of labor, leading to the pathology of French society. Only when there is a normal division of labor constitutes solidarity, but there is an abnormal division of labor. Two important dimensions of abnormal division of labor is discussed by Emile Durkheim. One is anomic division of labor, which was the problem, which was the cause of the problem faced by French society, and forced division of labor, which was a socially, structurally created pathology. Write about anomic division of labor. Anomy means confusion, normlessness, because of either too many norms, polynormativism, or because of the normative deregulation, that norms have lost its power to regulate the human behavior. The consequences of anomy is felt in different layers of the society, that in the industrial realm of society, there is a trade union conflict against that of the owners, resulting in industrial lockouts, unemployment, poverty. Trade union is only representing a collective greed, whereas the owners represented the individual greed. He is also suggesting solution to address the problem of anomie in France. He wanted the companies to be converted into corporations. The corporation should be converted into communities, where social security will have to be guaranteed for the workers. Professional associations will have to administer the code of ethics, and professionals should be represented in the parliament. They should make law which takes care of the grievances of all members of the society. Thereby, peace and tranquility will prevail in France. He also speaks about some societies where beneath the social structure lies inequality. So division of labor is not based on merit, but based on birth. And the structurally created inequality can be resolved only by abolition of inheritance of private property. A true patriot, Emile Durkheim, wanted to resolve the crisis in France. His goal was to use sociological theories to reconstruct France so that France will be a place of peace, tranquility, order, happiness, and characterized, and it will be characterized by prosperity. So emergence of sociology should be attributed to the social condition which prevailed in 19th century France. The condition was a culmination of social, political and economic transformations. The transformation resulted in confusion. It was attempting to create a new order with the collapse of the old order. An era of scientific thought to be replacing to superstition and dogmas propagated in the name of religion. A new political condition which would be guaranteeing equality by replacing hierarchy, and the fruits of capitalism shall be distributed across all members of society based on the principles of merit. So society of Europe was witnessing an upheaval, a drastic transformation from the old to new. Such transformations were seen by some as a sign of progress, called as liberal scholars, and by few as a sign of regress, belonging to the school of conservatism. So, sociology was a product of the debate between these two branches of scholars, the liberals and the conservatives. There was an effervescence of ideas. There was an effervescence of ideas coming out of the intensive debate between the supporters of modern society and one who glorified the traditional society, wanting the new society to be abolished and preferred to go back to the past. Next, you speak about how economic changes not only created new system of economics and market, but also created a new system of family, religion, education. Industrial Revolution was a product of scientific revolution which started since 14th century. A feudal society was replaced by capitalist society. Handmade production was replaced by machine-made production. The feudal order was collapsing, and a new order, economic order, characterized by skills and merit, was by new economic institutions, market and factory. In 1776, Adam Smith writes in his Wealth of Nation how industrial revolution creates not just a new system of economics, but also politics and larger social changes. Capitalism was also supporting urbanization, new working class, new choices, rise of private property as a constitutional guarantee, new preferences, and interconnection amongst the unconnected, hitherto unconnected markets. So distribution of goods and services is not decided by the rigid social structure, but it was decided by the individual merit and the personal accomplishments. Adam Smith speaks about how there is an invisible hand present in the free market economy which will distribute goods and services freely, which will make a nation wealthy. But industrial revolution was not just a story of prosperity, it was really characterized by inequality and impoverishment for radical scholars like Karl Marx. Marx looks at how capitalism is anti-human. Capitalism only leads to proliferation of the propertyless and exploitation of the working class by the owners of property. He wanted the banishment of the society through the rise of communism. So industrial revolution was a seed that created a new society which is drastically different from the old hierarchical feudal society. Industrial revolution is not just an economic revolution, it should be rightly called as a social revolution. For the impact which it created in different realms of the social institutions and the social groups. When economic modernity was brought forward by industrial revolution, political modernity was attempted through French Revolution and American War of Independence. Social, political, economic changes were primarily rooted in the Enlightenment period, which questioned the role of religion, which discarded superstitions, which advocated science and rationality to dominate the larger society. So it was Renaissance which gave a foundation for political, social and economic changes, and that what resulted in modern society, necessitating a study of modern society, thereby compelling for the rise of a new discipline called the sociology. Political changes were introduced during French Revolution as against the Orthodox Church at Versailles, which was incompassionate to the plights of the common man. The feudal society of France was divided into three classes: the clergy, the nobility, and the commoners. The exploitation which was meted out by the commoners resulted in the need for liberty, fraternity and social justice, and that underscored the emergence of political revolution in the form of French Revolution. Rousseau wanted a society to be characterized by general will, and this society will be guaranteeing equality for all, and it will give opportunity to develop personality according to their ability. So he wanted a social contract to replace to the old monarchical order, which was characterized by inequality and exploitation. American War of Independence provided new institutions of modernity like independent judiciary, universal adult franchise, separation of powers, and that what created political social revolutions in different parts of Europe. So the entire Europe was moving in the direction of modernity. Modernity is not with full of prosperity. Modernity has its own limitation. Modernity is a mixture of contradictions. On one hand, modernity was giving opportunity, was promising opportunity, but in real, modernity only resulted in disillusionment amongst the masses. So when Renaissance scholars, when Enlightenment scholars wanted to use reason and logic to reconstruct a society which is modern in nature, it was conservatives like Louis Bonald, Joseph de Maistre, who criticizes the rise of the modern society as characterized by loss of compassion, loss of tolerance, and loss of community life, replaced by association, which is formal. So modern society made people prosperous but not happy. Modernity has only created sufferings of the society. So modern society cannot be cherished as an opportunity for a higher living for humanity. So modern society was seen as guaranteeing a new order of equality by liberal scholars, whereas it was ridiculed, it was criticized by the conservative scholars. And the fertilization of these two currents of thoughts resulted in the rise of sociology as a distinct discipline to study the modern society. So modern society provides changes. Every change comes with challenges and problems. Problems we need to be identified. It has to be corrected, for which there is a need for a new discipline to be dedicated to the study of modern society and solve the problems of the modern society, thereby create conditions of happiness for all in the rise of the new society. And this is what is the main reason for emergence of sociology as a scientific study of society in 19th century. In conclusion, a student of sociology can argue that rise of modern society and emergence of sociology are the two sides of the same coin. Modern society, study of modern society, happens to be the subject matter of sociology. Study of modern society happens to be the heart and soul of sociology. So sociology is nothing but study of modernity. In the introduction, what you'll write? Emile Durkheim studies suicide for what? That should be your introduction. So always in the introduction, you write why that concept came to be studied by that thinker. Why that concept came to be studied by that thinker should be your introduction. What is the reason for Emile Durkheim to study suicide? Why should he study suicide? So, Emile Durkheim wanted sociology to have an independent subject matter. Then only sociology can become an independent discipline. So Durkheim wanted sociology to become a matured discipline on par with the other social sciences. Hence he is giving a subject matter unique to sociology called a social fact. Social fact is socially created. Sociology having subject matter as social fact will have to study exclusively the social dimension of a physical reality, an individual reality. There was skepticism about the power of sociology to study individual act as a social fact. He wanted to prove that sociology can study personal act as a social fact. The most personalized act of the human being is suicide. So if he can study suicide as a social fact, he can study any physical fact, any individual fact as a social fact, for which he chose the study of suicide as a social fact. For the first time, he is making a positivistic study of suicide, which was regarded as a psychic act. Psychology reduced suicide to psychic act. Durkheim wanted to study how society influences the psyche of the individual through this study on suicide. This should be your introduction. He is making a genuine attempt to make a scientific study of suicide by defining suicide for the first time. Every scientific study will have to start with a definition, a positivistic definition, which he did. After defining suicide, he was collecting empirical data. 26,000 cases of suicide spanning for 40 years, 1940 to 1970, was 26,000 cases of suicide from 1840 to 1870 for 30 years was collected by Emile Durkheim. So collected the data, he processed the data by classification of the data. He classified the data based on the societies. He found that there is a social rate of suicide if suicide is because of psychic act. Then there may not be a constancy in the rate of suicide. He found constancy in the rate of suicide. He says, every society is having a quota of suicide. there is present a pseudogenic current which was created by society, which is the primary reason for constancy in the rate of suicide. He is not dismissing the role of psychic determinism, but he gives importance to social determinism and not to psychic predisposition. He accepts that psychological aspect is also present in suicide, but he attributes maximum reason to the social aspect given the subject matter of sociology. Whenever there is a change in the social structure, when there is a change in the society, the suicide rate changes. When there is no change in the society, suicide rate is not changing. So the reason is not mind, the reason is society. When suicide is not a social act, it is not a psychic act, it is a social fact. He classified suicide in terms of gender, in terms of religion, in terms of marriage, in terms of peace and war. He found how suicide was regulated by two important forces. Suicide was determined by two important forces. Number one is regulation, and number two is integration. He found in his classification of data that social solidarity is one important determinant of suicide rate. Protestant men, wartime, family with no children, in these cases there is a high rate of suicide as against Catholics, family with more children and women, as well as wartime. So he even went to the extent of deriving a law of suicide, that suicide rate is inversely proportional to solidarity. He is making a classificatory typology, classifying suicide into four types, determined by two important forces, integration and regulation. The four types of suicides are anomic suicide, egoistic suicide, fatalistic suicide and altruistic suicide. Explain. However, phenomenologists like Atkinson refuses to accept the reliability of the data used by suicide, by Durkheim in a study of suicide. Douglas speaks about the social meaning of suicide. Psychologists give importance to imitation, which decides or which has a role to influence the rate of the suicide. Biological theories speak about the role of hormones, which decides the rate of the suicide. Despite of all these limitations, Durkheim is a pioneer of modern sociology for the single most reason that it was Durkheim who gave an identity to sociology by defining the subject matter of sociology, by offering a methodology of sociology, for which he is rightly called as the father of modern sociology. So you have to first speak about what? Collective concerns. You can start with even social realism. Emile Durkheim wanted the social reality to be studied by sociologists. He identified the subject matter of sociology as social fact. And for him, the ultimate social fact is collective concerns, which refers to the totality of beliefs and sentiments which is shared by the average type members of the society. after using the concept of collective conscience in his division of labor, he found that this concept is all embracing and it is static, with which you cannot understand the dynamic aspect present in reality. So to identify the internal dynamics of society, to find out the internal working of the social institutions and the social process, he is replacing the concept of collective conscience by representations collective, or representation, or collective representations. This RC is nothing but the segregation of CC. It comes out of collectivity. It is about the collectivity. It is external to the collective. It is independent of the collective. It is diffused across all the members of the society and it controls the collective. It may prohibit an individual to act in a particular way. It may propose an individual to act in a particular way. So it may aid the individual action. It may restrict the individual action, because it is the collective tendency which influences the individual thought and individual action. It is independent of the individual. Individuals follow the RC. Even though they are contributing to RC, they are guided by RC. For example, religion. Religion is external to the individual. Every member of the society will become a member of the religious community. Religion don't disappear with the fall of the individual. The customs, institutions, they are created by individual, but once they are created, they become a sui generis reality and they now started guiding the individual. Even though the individual is having a choice to choose, the individual chooses the normative pattern of the society. He hesitates to deviate from the social norms of the society. This RC is present everywhere. It is not class dependent. It permeates the entire society. It diffuses all through the society. And it now controls the society. It regulates the society. So RC is the reason for social control. Hunger may be biologically motivated, but how a member of the society should satisfy his hunger is decided by the cultural norm. There may be a society which may eat snake. There may be a society which may worship the snake. So, it is society which guides the individual action. A set of taboos, do's and don'ts, is given by this RC. No society encourages its own members to kill another member. In India, you have Gotra exogamy, that members of the same Gotra shall not marry each other. Sagotra marriage is prohibited. In case of North India, cross cousin marriage is prohibited. But in South India, cross-cousin marriage is preferred. Village exogamy in North India, village endogamy in South India. classificatory kinship system is present in North India. So kinship term varies. Institution, the rituals varies. And all the members of the society shall follow the norms of that society. So individual action is determined by the social customs and in modern society by the constitution. Customs may be replaced by constitution. Now constitution becomes a new RCE. Rule of law becomes new RCE. National flag becomes new RCE. National song becomes new RCE. Even though individual wrote the constitution, a group of individuals wrote the constitution, but constitution becomes supreme once it was written. Speaks about the role of RC, which guides the human action. Even though RC was contributed by the individual members, but once created, RC becomes the ultimate reality. Social structure guides the human behavior. Now what you should write? Write about collective consents. Start writing. I told you the social structure, how social structure guides the human behavior. Study of social structure guiding human behavior is the prime area of interest for positivists. Auguste Comte says there are three different social structures in his law of three stages. Theological social structure determined by religion, metaphysical social structure characterized by philosophical debate, and scientific social structure driven by the logic of rationality and science or secularism. So social structure guides human action. In the stage 1, individuals are guided by religion. In stage 2, there is a philosophical debate. In stage 3, people are driven by secularism. And social structure changes, leading to societal changes. Emile Durkheim looks at how social structure constitutes a collective consciousness shared by all the members of the society. He says collective conscience refers to the totality of beliefs and sentiments commonly shared by all members of the society. People think alike in a given society because of the cultural similarities. In a simple society, collective conscience volume is very high. But in a complex society, the volume reduces, intensity reduces, determinateness reduces, and the content becomes secular. So change of the collective conscience reflects the change of society from mechanical solidarity to organic solidarity. Collective conscience is representing the will of the people. And even state is an executive organ of the collective conscience. State gets legitimacy from collective conscience. An act becomes crime only if it is offending collective conscience. The Supreme Court has propounded a doctrine called as rarest of the rare. for awarding death penalty, where the court says if any act shakes the collective conscience, then the punishment preferred is death penalty. So collective consciousness drives the human action, decides the nature of the society, social practices and the customs of the society. His excessive emphasis on collective conscience, providing no role for individual initiatives, was later criticized by non-positivists. Weber, in his concept of charismatic authority, criticizes Immanuel Durkheim's concept of collectivity. He gives importance to individual who can guide the collective through charismatic authority. So history is not always a product of collectivity. Individuals make history, individuals recreate the history. So history is not a product of always collective conscience. History may be guided by individual conscience, as a result of which individuals like Gandhi, Martin Luther King, Mother Teresa, they became new collective conscience. The source of change is always not located in society. Rather, individual can be a reason for social change. A criticism against the concept of collective conscience given by Immanuel Durkheim. The question is about phenomenology. The question is on phenomenology. I'm asking question on phenomenology. So phenomenology, why it came to criticize positivism, came phenomenology, that should be your introduction. Positivism makes sociology as a science, attempts to make sociology as a science, but non-positivism rejected scientific status of sociology, wanted sociology to be totally different from the cognitive aim of science. Phenomenology of Edmund Husserl and Alfred Schutz gives importance to the individual perception about reality. Reality, according to them, is a product of mind. They don't deny the existence of physical reality. They say that individual uses his mind, conceives reality through his imagination, through his assumption. So reality cannot be judged as whether it is true or false, because reality is individual imagination. For ethno-methodology, reality or social order is only a fiction. Individuals are having sensory organ to sense the external world, but possessing sensory organ will not make them sensible. They apply their mind to process the sensory input and categorize the world into different realities based on their individual experience. They classify the objects into animate, inanimate, classify animate into species, animate into mammals. So classification of reality is purely guided by individual mind. Alfred Schutz also says, there is present a common sense. Using common sense, people construct reality. So phenomenological approach is called as constructionist approach. Constructionist approach. Reality is a construction. It is a product of your mental imagination. Hence, phenomenology wanted sociology to become enriched with multiple dimensions, not just confined to only the principles of natural science. Phenomenology contributed for the rise of new vistas of inquiry into the sociological understanding of social reality, hence enriches sociology as a multidisciplinary subject.